Would you stand with us this morning and let's praise the Lord? We praise you, Lord.
Amen. Welcome to Stratford Heights this morning. Let's just give it up for these kids this morning. Let's give it up for them. Beautiful, beautiful, wonderful children. This is the Joyful Noise Children's Choir under the direction of Linda Ingham. She's right there in the back. Want to give it up for them one more time. They are here to praise and worship with us today, and it's going to be a wonderful time. It's an exciting time around the church here. It's Easter time. It's a wonderful time for all of us to be together, and we are gearing up. Now we shift into high gear. All this week we'll be practicing our singing and our drama and things all this week, and we just put every effort as a church into this next coming weekend. It's a wonderful time where hundreds, over thousands of people come to our church this next coming weekend on Friday night, Saturday night at 7 o'clock, then on Sunday morning at the 9 a.m. preaching service, then at the 11 o'clock we're going to run the program again. It is a huge weekend. We're inviting tons of people. We know that you're inviting people and encouraging people to come, and it's just a wonderful time. The whole church comes together with all the practice and everything that we do and everything that comes together. We take time off from all the rest of the services, so there'll be no services this week, but that is just so we can focus on being at our absolute best for next weekend. Amen? Amen. Amen. With that being said, we want you to know that here in just a little while after the end of our service, you're visiting with us today, or if you've been here for just a couple of weeks, a month, and you'd like to meet the staff and kind of get to know the church a little better, we have a meet and greet right across the lobby in the conference room. We'd love you to come by and just chat with us for a moment. We'd love to get to meet you. With that also being said, we are looking for people to serve around the church next weekend, greeters, people to help in the parking lot, just all kinds of different places for people, and all you have to do is have a smiling face and just love people and welcome people. With that being said, we want you to shake a couple of hands around you as we get ready to go on with the service. Thank you so much for being here today.
Amen. If you would like to have your children be a part of our children's choir, they rehearse every Wednesday night at 6:30. You'd have them here. They could be a part of this. They're going to be doing a number with the choir here in a little bit. We thought we would just take this time and have some generational worship and let the kids be involved in our praise and worship. How many know that children are great worshipers? That's right. What can wash away my sin?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can make me? What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can wash away my sin?
Hold the elements of communion this morning. We're going to go back a couple thousand years. As you remember, communion is not something that's been instituted by the church, not by any preacher, no particular denomination. It was not created by any man. It was Jesus on the night he was betrayed that took bread in his hands, looked at his disciples. And you know what? He knew that as we got down generation after generation, he knew that people were going to start to think it was their goodness or because they're worth it, they're valuable, their righteousness is godliness. They would start to imagine that goodness was in them. So Jesus strategized something beautiful that you could only get from heaven. I mean, the mere fact that this sacrament is so amazing and beautiful and yet so precise in how it touches our lives. Jesus wanted to leave them something that would cause them to never forget that it is not their goodness. It's nothing we can do. That's the awesome thing about it. The righteousness that we have comes from Christ. We sing about the blood, not because the blood is something we celebrate. We're not morbid people. We know that the cross and the crucifixion was a horrifying event. But we know that that was God come to earth, living a sinless life, taking on our sin, and dying for us. So through his sacrifice, we have been given eternal life. So we celebrate today this communion because Jesus said, as oft as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, I want you to do this in remembrance of me. Remember, it's my sacrifice. It's the cross. It's what I've done for you that gives you sonship and daughtership in the kingdom of God. So today we take our elements and we remember it wasn't instituted by a church, it was instituted by Jesus himself. You're holding elements that Jesus gave to the church. And it was used to always help us remember his body and his blood. And as you hold those elements, I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. It begins and Paul writes, says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner also, he took the cup. When he had supped, he said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Then he goes on to explain. He says, "For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup of the Lord, you do show the Lord's death till he come." How many of you know there'll be one more communion in heaven, and that's going to be the marriage supper of the Lamb? When we're gathered together in his presence, I believe that more than I believe in you, that you exist. I believe that Jesus Christ is my Savior and my Lord, and I will sup with him in the kingdom at the marriage supper of the Lamb. I am so happy this morning to know I am a child of God. Amen? Amen. So as we hold these elements, it goes on, and Paul writes and says, "But whosoever shall eat this bread or drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup." I want you to take just a moment to just remember that you're not following a sacrament. You're not following a church doctrine. You're not doing this because of some theology. You're doing this because Jesus gave it to us. And he wanted us to remember him. And so we're remembering him today. And as we do that, we praise him and honor him for the sacrifice that he gave for us. Would you take just a moment now and just do introspect in your own heart and prepare yourself for communion today. And so, Lord, we now come to remember you, and we thank you. And when he had given thanks, the Lord took the bread, and he broke it. He gave thanks, and he looked into their eyes, and he said, "This is my body that is broken for you. So often as you eat this bread, remember what I've done for you." And they ate. We thank you, Lord, for your body. We thank you for the incarnation, you coming from heaven's throne to the earth to live a sinless life, becoming man so that you could redeem us with your sacrifice. We remember your body today, bruised, battered, and broken for us. In the same manner, he took the cup. He said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. As often as you drink it, remember, do it in remembrance of me. What I've done for you through my blood," they drank. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for remission of my sins. Thank you for cleansing that comes. Lord, that you love the whole world so much that you gave that we might be redeemed. We give you honor today and we thank you in the blessed name of Jesus Christ. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood, blood. We thank you, Lord. We honor you, Jesus. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. Oh, we honor you. We praise you, Jesus. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Special prayer. The staff is coming to pray for you. Feel free to come down.
Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice.
how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Go see how great is our God.
We're going to have a moment of prayer together for the state of Israel, for the world, and all that's going on in the world. But I needed to share something with you that I wanted to share with you right now. As they were singing about how great is our God, I wanted to share about a miracle. How many of you would love to hear some good news? You know, every now and again, God just does something so amazing to show himself. I don't know where you are in your relationship with him. I don't know whether you're so far away that you can't even sense or feel his presence in the world or not. But I'm telling you, this weekend, God revealed himself in the most supernatural, most amazing way, and I have to share it with you. It started out with bad news. Kristen Bowman, Shane, usually sit right back there. She is Kristen Carpenter. You might remember Danny and Sandy's daughter, Kristen. Well, Kristen has been pregnant, and she is at 31 weeks. A couple of weeks ago, actually about a month ago, that she received word that she had developed a rare, very rare disease. 5% of women who carry children have this disease. The disease is one that the placenta in her body was literally wrapping itself around and penetrating the organs of her body. Dangerous. The mortality rate for this is extremely high. So much so that I sat in the room while the family was being talked to by the surgeon, who began to tell them that there would be 7 surgeons in the OR. That they would have 10 units of blood in the room on standby. The disease that she has, when they would begin to disconnect the placenta from these organs in her body, there would be a coagulation problem and her blood would not clot. Long story short, she would bleed to death in minutes. The death rate for this, it's the number one killer for women who carry children. Here she is facing this. She had an emergency. They called me up to the hospital and I went to be with them, and the surgeon was explaining all the details of how this didn't look good, and there was tears. The mortality rate was high and the risk was higher, that the likelihood that Kristen would come off that table was a whole lot less than it would be to her favor. Everyone sat there devastated. It was Kristen who looked over at her mother and she said, "See, the little girl they're going to have is named Ellie Hope." Kristen looked at her mother and she said, "If I don't come out, I want you to call her Ellie Kristen after her mom." It was devastating. We were all there. The family convened, come from everywhere. Waiting room was full. They were getting ready for the surgery. What they would do is they would take the child from her and then they would start the 6.5-hour surgery to try to save her life. So we waited. They took her down. I felt in my heart, there were hundreds of people. Some of you, I'm sure, were praying for Kristen and the baby. So many people lifting up her name to God. Heaven had to have heard the prayers of all the people that were knocking on heaven's door. The Lord laid it on my heart to go to the chapel of the hospital. When I got to the chapel, I got in there, and I'm just going to be blunt with you and honest about the conversation I had that I felt like was directly from the Lord. We were going back and forth, and I was praying and asking for a miracle, and I was praying over Ellie, and I was praying over Kristen and the family, and I was asking God for a miracle. I said, "God, I believe you're a miracle-working God. I wouldn't do what I do if I didn't believe it. I'm not in this for the career. I'm in this because I'm a child of God and I believe in Him. And so I said, Lord, this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where I'm asking for a miracle. And it just so happens that this was the chapel that years ago, when my mother had coded on an operating table and had died, and they brought her back to life, and the odds were horrible that she would survive. Me and my five sisters got in that same little chapel, and we brought the Holy Ghost down in that room. And we prayed the power of the Lord, and my mother was granted 3.5 more years after the doctor said she would not live. So I already knew there had been a miracle that had happened right there. And when I felt like I'd prayed it through, I looked up and I said, God, you gave my mom a miracle in this very chapel. I stood in the very spot where I prayed for my mother. And I said, I'm coming to you today, and I'm asking you. I was so broken. I said, I'm coming to you, and I'm asking God, I'm asking that you give another mom another miracle today. And I felt the Holy Ghost hit me in the top of my head. As a matter of fact, I felt so much power in that moment, RJ, that I knew that God had heard me, and I knew that it was going to be all right. He spoke into my spirit right in that moment, and He said, she'll live. I knew that it was going to be okay. I knew it. Now listen, I had not been given a report from any doctor at this point. I just knew that God had spoken. I looked up and I became so bold because I knew it was Him that I said, all right, thank you, God. I felt the Holy Ghost. I said, okay, here's what we want. I said, we want it to shock the doctors, to astound the family. I want it to be a miracle that nobody can deny, and everybody is looking at it, and it's a testimony to you and to your power. Show us a modern day miracle, Lord, in these days. I was bold. I went up to the waiting room. I got over by the Carpenter family, and we're all talking. I got down beside of them, and I said, and I wouldn't do this on my own. What if something would go wrong? I looked at him and I said, it's going to be all right. The Lord told me it's going to be all right. Sandy had told me yesterday, she said, as soon as you came up out of that chapel, she said, I knew something had happened. She goes, for the first time in days, I had peace. And I knew it was God. We all knew it was God. God was doing something to show them and to show you that He is still mighty and powerful on the throne. Because listen, listen, here's the good report. They started the surgery. They took the baby. They said the baby would be critical. The baby was at 31 weeks. So she would be critical. She would have to be intubated. She would have all these problems and complications. They went in. They took the baby from her. And Shane was standing by to rush the baby to the NIC unit. The doctor came out, or one of the nurses came out, right? The baby's been delivered, and she's great. She's good. No problem. She's breathing great. They took her upstairs. They had intubated her for a few hours, and then they took her off of it because they said she doesn't need it. And now today, here she's doing great. God has touched her. She's doing fantastic. So that was the first miracle. And what I said, I looked up and I said, score one. That's what I said. I said, score one. And then we waited. It was going to be 6.5 hours, Amelia, from the time Ellie was born, 6.5 hours of waiting in Kettering Hospital where you work. 2 hours. A nurse came out. It was 1.5 hours. She came out and she said, they're going to come out and talk to you. Something's changed. And of course, everyone was like, oh no, what's going on? So, but they'll be out. They'll be out a little while, about 30 minutes. We waited 30 minutes. The surgeon came out and she said, we're done. It's over. She said, she's fine. She's not going to go to ICU. She's in recovery for 45 minutes and you can see her and you can be with her. Here's the part that I got to get to you. It's easy to celebrate if I just throw that out there, but I'm going to make it harder. The doctor said the placenta had traumatized the bladder. had invaded the other organs. It was going to be this massive surgery, 10 units of blood. She probably would not make it, but here we are. The doctor has the scans, has all the tests, has everything that shows this happened. But the surgeon said, funny thing, when we got in there, the placenta was wrapped around all the organs, but had not entered any one of them. Had not, my Lord, hallelujah, had not touched any of them. They were fine. No trouble. The nurse, the doctor, the surgeon said, we had 10 units of blood. We used two. We were planning for 6.5 hours and we're completely done in 2 hours. You can see her in 45 minutes and she'll probably be holding her baby by nightfall. That is a miracle from Almighty God. That's a miracle from Almighty God. I believe it and I know it. And I'm so thankful this morning. I looked up. When the doctor, I took pictures of the doctor telling the family and everybody going, oh, it was so great. I looked up into that ceiling and I said, score one, score two, score three. And I said, thank you. Thank you. God is a miracle working God, Jimmy. He still does miracles. He's awesome. I don't know what it was. All day long, I couldn't hardly stand myself. I was crying in my car. I'm praying out loud in my car. I get to somebody's house and I'm like, let me tell you what happened. It's awesome. Hey, have you heard what happened? It's a miracle. I felt like I was running out of the empty tomb in Jerusalem, telling everybody, he is risen. He's alive. He's alive. You know, that's what I felt like. Amazing. Amazing. God still moves mighty. She still needs prayer. She just had surgery, right? Y'all keep her in your prayers. And little Ellie, an amazing thing about little Ellie, I got out, I went out to my car and right there parked by my car was a little bumper sticker on the car and I looked down at it. It was like God was just sending a little message, just little stuff like text messages, a hashtag. God was sending me a hashtag. It said, hope is a verb. Hope is a verb. Little Ellie Hope is alive and well, and she's a verb. She's alive, and God has put his hand on her life. Why don't you just give the Lord a hand clap of praise and honor today? Hallelujah. Lord, we honor you. We thank you, and we bless your name. We bless you, Father. We thank you, Jesus.
Worthy of all.
So Father, we come to you now, and I pray over every family, every heart, every life. God, we have faith this morning, not in ourselves, not in even our own prayers. We have faith in an awesome, mighty God. You created the earth. You gave your life for us. You've given us your word to stand on. So Lord, I pray over every family, every circumstance and situation represented in this house. I pray for the presence and the power of God to touch hearts and lives. Reveal your love to people who aren't sure. Reveal your love again to folks who need to get through the valleys of doubt and discouragement. Touch them by your mighty spirit. Meet every need. And Lord, we pray today for the state of Israel. We pray over her, Lord. Protect her her borders and her soldiers. Protect her, Father, in the name of Jesus. You said in your word to seek the good of Israel. You told us, Father, to bless her. And so, Lord, we do that now in this service. While at the same time, we're asking you, Lord, to touch brothers and sisters all around the world. Lord, those that are being tormented and tortured for their faith. those that are being blown up and attacked. Father, touch them in the name of Jesus Christ. Be with them. Lay your hand upon them and keep them. And Lord, let the love of Christ, the love of God, intervene in every life. Lost, sinners, saints, every person alive and breathing on this earth, no matter what background, no matter what religion they find themselves in, God, touch them. Touch them with your love. And we thank you for it and honor you for it in the name of Jesus. And Lord, bless the United States of America. Be with our country. Touch our cities, our sons, our daughters. Touch our people, Lord, and minister your strength and your love. So we honor you and we thank you for it today. In Christ's name we pray. The name that is above every other name. The name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Sweet the Savior rescued me.
Amen. You can be seated. Wow. Didn't they do wonderful? Excellent. You ought to see what you look like from up here. My goodness. God is blessing our church. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So good to see you, and thank you for being here. I feel like I need to tell you this. You know, there's probably 200-300 people at the first service, but there's more room there. So if it does get a little tough, you're certainly welcome to try the 9 o'clock. How many of you know God moved in the 9 o'clock service just like he moves in this one? So we do invite you to check that one out just in case feel like you're a little claustrophobic. You know, but it's wonderful. It's wonderful to see you and all that God's doing in our church. Our ushers are coming to serve you today. And as they do, we honor the Lord with our gifts. So thankful for how he is blessing, as I said, our church. We have two wonderful people who God has called out of our congregation to be missionaries. That's Todd and Rhonda Taylor. They have a booth out in the lobby today, the main lobby here. Go by and see their pictures and get some information and talk with them. They're going to be out there today answering any questions you have about what's upcoming for them. They're going to be leaving us in a couple of weeks to go down for a trip to Paraguay, where they are being called to minister. And if you remember, back about 25 years ago, we started a ministry there to what was known then as the Children of the Dump. And the only reason we called them that, those people called them that, was because these were children and families that have built all of their life, their houses, everything they have is built out of a garbage refuge place, a landfill that they have there. And so the kids are known affectionately throughout that city as Children of the Dump. And so we started a ministry there, bought them a truck and helped them to get up a school running there and an orphanage that was running there for many years. And through the years, that has kind of struggled, and a lot of different things have gone wrong. And God, right about the time that things were going so wrong that they couldn't even function anymore, Todd and Rhonda Taylor were called of God to go down, and their heart is burning within them to minister to the kids at the dump. And so they immediately changed the name of the ministry to Hope for the Dump, and that is what it's now being called, and that's what we're going to focus on. And we're going to focus on ministry to the children, and we're going to be, not only are they going to be going to live there and to be missionaries there, but we also will be joining them 1 year from now, August of 2018. We'll be taking a mission trip to go down to Paraguay. By that time, they should be good and settled and have a lot of projects, painting, and work for us to do as a congregation. So I would challenge you now to be praying. If you have skill sets, plumbing, electric, painting, or if you're just really, really awesome at furniture display, if you know where to put a couch and put a painting, and if you know how to design, then you're welcome to go with us. If you want to minister to children, we'll be having rallies and ministering to children, and we'll also be preaching in churches. So a lot that'll be happening 1 year from now in August, and we want you to be praying about being a part of that mission team. But in the meantime, we have a lot of missionaries that we support, Todd and Rhonda being our own. So we're asking you to go by, see them, talk to them. What we're eventually, in a couple of weeks, they're going to be presenting to our church, and we're going to be looking for people who will partner with them to give to them on a regular basis in order to help them in the ministry down in Paraguay. So be praying about that. But in the meantime, your gifts today will go to our missionaries around the world. All the loose offering every Sunday at both services, 9 and 11, always go to our missionaries. So we want to meet the needs. We have literally missions in Romania, South America, Eastern and Western Europe, Africa, and South America, I mentioned. And then we have Alaska, the Barrow Church, way up at the top of the world. We help them. So we're literally spread out all over the world helping people. And that's what makes, I believe, the blessing here so rich and good, because we carry it out of here and we go and help others. Amen? Amen. So we're asking you to be a part of that today, and thank you for those who are faithful to support your local church with your tithe. Let's pray. Father, we thank you today. We honor you. I thank you for the crowd that's here. I thank you for the 15 that were saved in the jail ministry. I thank you for those who came to you, that came to Christ in the first service today. Lord, we're believing for others who will come to know you as their Savior today in this service. I pray in the name of Jesus you would bless and touch every missionary. God, we're asking you to touch them in every work they're doing around the world. And Lord, especially that your hand will rest on Todd and Rhonda Taylor. Lord, as we have adopted them, they're part of us, missionaries, literally leaving from this house. So we honor you, God, and we want to do everything we can to support them in prayer and to help them in financial means. Take our offerings today. Take our tithing. Let it be to the glory and honor of the work that you're doing for the kingdom in this city and through us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Trying to fill the same old holes inside. There's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh. Well, we've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. But there's a better life. There's a better life. Now if you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Tell him one more time.
We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. And we've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight.
Same old fight.
And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. But there's a better life. There's a better life.
Now if you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker.
Way maker.
You need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, well, if you got pain, he's a pain taker.
Pain taker.
If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Oh, yeah. Listen to this.
Receive it. If you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it,
you believe it.
If you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it,
you believe it.
If you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. Pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain
saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Yes, he is. Amen.
Give him praise. He's the chain breaker.
How many of you have experienced him as the chain breaker? Amen, amen. Great song. Love it. Wow. If you have your Bibles and you stand with me, please. Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. Going to read down several scriptures. Going to tell the story one more time. As we're telling the Easter story, this series we've been in, we're looking again today at the resurrection and at the empty tomb. While you're turning to Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12, did want to make an announcement about something special for you tonight. The Men of Valor will be singing in the service this evening at 6 p.m. So I know some of you, you always want to know when they're going to be singing, and so we want to make sure you know that'll be tonight. They're a wonderful group of men that sing beautiful music. I understand they're actually getting ready to record a brand new CD. And so we're proud of them. They travel quite a bit. A lot of folks get them signed up to come, and they're part of us. So you come tonight, and you hear the Men of Valor in the service at 6 p.m. Also, the meet and greet. Richard mentioned the meet and greet. Right after this service, you'll go right through this hallway, across the lobby, and there's a room right there where there'll be some refreshments, and our staff will be there, and we look forward to meeting you today. If you've been here at the church, you've been coming new for the last several months, you're certainly welcome to come by and to greet our staff. Also, I want to thank Missy Osborne. Is she in here? There she is. Missy, thank you so much for yesterday, our children's event over at Sunset Park, the Easter egg hunt. 15,000 eggs, and kids were everywhere. There was well over 1,000 kids, and each one of them got the gospel message, got message about our church, and got some coloring items that they could color so they could do, and all about the message of the resurrection in Jesus Christ. We're very proud of all those who volunteered, lots of workers, and thank you so much for representing our church and the Lord over yesterday's event. Missy, thank you. She spearheaded that. One more time, give Missy appreciation. She worked hard, and I got a kick out of the fact that one of the families brought one of the eggs, and you know, they put the eggs all out in this field of grass, and one of the eggs, they got a surprise. All the kids got surprises, but one got a surprise they weren't counting on, and that was that a snail crawled inside the egg. And so I looked down at him, and I said, "No more chocolate for you." But we appreciate all those who worked hard. Let's look at the first day of the week, a beautiful morning. I love morning. How many of you love mornings? You're morning people. Let me see the morning people. I'm a morning person. I'm not a late night person. You talk to me at 10 o'clock at night, and I'm liable to tell you that I'm the president of the U.S. So I don't do well at night. But in the morning, man, I'm raring to go. I'm ready. Got my Diet Coke with lime, and I'm on fire. Mornings, the opportunity to start over, to redo. Mornings, the opportunity that we get to see things fresh. And boy, so many different mornings are beautiful in the presence of God as well. Let's look at one early morning. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women were with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.'" They remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, mother, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales. They did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping down. He saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. Now jump down to verse 36. Now as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were terrified and frightened. Suppose they had seen a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, and that it is I myself." Then Jesus said, "Handle me, see, for a spirit doesn't have flesh and bones as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. But while they still did not believe for joy and marveled, he said to them, "Have you any food here?" So they gave him a piece of broiled fish and some honeycomb. And he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me." And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. Then he said to them, "Thus it is written, thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem." And then verse 48, "And you are witnesses of these things." Can you say amen to the reading of God's word? Father, we come to you, ask you to touch us in the few minutes we have today. Challenge our hearts and speak to us. We thank you for it, Lord. Let this preacher step out of the way. Let the words be yours. Let your anointing touch and meet the need of the heart of every man, woman, boy, and girl here today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You can be seated. What struck me in this text that we're reading is where Jesus kind of went out of his way to make sure they understood how real he was, that he was really him. He said, "Behold, look at my hands, look at my feet." He said, it's I, it's myself. I mean, you can almost see him, you know, "Hey, guys, look, it's me. Can you not tell? It's I, it's really me." And as he was saying this, he said, "Handle me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." And it says, "But while they still did not believe for joy." You know what that means, don't you? I mean, that's like a strange concoction of words. It really just means that they thought it was too good to be true. Too good to be true. While they still did not believe for joy and marveled, he said to them, it's like he was trying to help them. Okay, look, see, touch. Do you not see? I have flesh and bones. I'm real. I really did rise from the dead, boys. He says, "You got food?" In other words, "I'll show you. I'll eat." So that they would believe. Jesus going out of his way to make sure, to let them know that he's real. Can I just tell you this morning? The Lord is searching for people that are looking to find out if he's real. He wants to show himself mighty and powerful. He wants to show himself as God. He wants you to believe in him. He wants you to stop allowing the distractions of this world, the busyness of this world, the temptations of this world to cause your faith to fade and your heart to become cold and indifferent. He doesn't want you and I to get to the place. Every now and again, he's just got to give us a flat-out miracle like he did over the weekend so that we marvel and are astounded at the fact that he's God on the throne. He's God. There are so many distractions in this life. If you're not careful, you'll get sidetracked. If you're not careful, your religion will become your thorn in the flesh. If you're not careful, you'll become faded in your faith and you'll follow men instead of following the Word and the Savior. If you're not careful, the best of Christians, the Bible says in the last days that even the very elect will be deceived. You've got to make sure you're not allowing the devil, that old slew foot, the dragon, to cause you to stumble and falter in your path. You've got to stay on the firing line of faith and believing God. And Jesus put communion there for us to keep remembering. He put all of these testimonials in the Word that are there for us to remember. And He gave us an empty tomb for us to always know there's no grave anywhere that'll hold the Savior, Jesus Christ. He's been risen from the dead. He doesn't want the distractions to keep us from Him. So much keeps us from seeing Him, experiencing Him. I know you get tired, you get busy, you get caught up in your job. You even sometimes get caught up in worldly events and things that like the even just the things that are not even wrong. I don't want to call them out, but you just stay so busy doing all kinds of stuff. It could be that you shop for antiques, but you've made it something so important that it consumes your time. I'm telling you, the world and the devil is a king of putting distractions in your path and trying to stop you and cause you to stumble and fall on your way to heaven. Jesus said, handle me. See me. He wants us to know Him. He wants us to know for Himself that He's alive. Yesterday when I looked up into that, or the other day when I looked up into the roof of that hospital, and they were all crying and celebrating, and pictures were being taken because the surgeon had come out and given them a brand new morning. It was like a brand new start. It was a fresh day. It was a beautiful day. Everything they had cried the whole night before, but the Word was true that said, weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. While they were doing that, I had that sense of His realness. I had that sense of His presence and His power. And I knew that God had showed up in a mighty way, that He'd answered a lot of people's prayers, a lot of people who had faith, who were calling out to God. But He let me know, hey, Ray, you're one of them. You prayed a prayer of faith, and I heard you. And He hears every one of us that call out to Him and that cry out to Him and search for Him. It was Jeremiah that said, if you will search for me and look for me with all of your heart, you will find me. When Jesus walked out of that tomb, I almost want to preach from right up there. When He walked out of that tomb, He didn't walk out and automatically just rise and ascend to the throne. No, He came out searching for His people. He wanted them to know. He couldn't wait for Mary to come back around. I mean, He's hiding over there in the greenery, and He's just waiting. He knew she was going to come. He's God. He knows everything. So here she comes. He can't wait. He can't wait as she turns and her eyes are not opened, and she's so full of tears and so swollen from crying all night and so caught up in her busyness and her distractions and her grief and her sorrow. She doesn't know until she hears Him say, Mary. And she opens her eyes, and she sees Him. Do you know He was excited about that? I believe that the Lord was sitting back going, watch this. Mary. He wanted her to know. He told her, He said, go tell my disciples and Peter. He wanted Peter to know. He knew that Peter, like the rest of us, got so caught up in what was happening and the circumstances that he couldn't think right, see right. Peter? You mean Peter? Yes, and you, and you, and you, and me. We get caught up in our circumstances sometimes, and it looks dark all around us, and sometimes it's hard to see with eyes of faith. Can I get an amen? Amen. He saw that Peter had went out. Where the scripture says he went out and he wept bitterly. He repented. So that one of the first things right out of the tomb, Austin, that Jesus wanted to do, he come walking out of the tomb, and he was just like looking for Mary. He got Mary, then he's sending her back, and he says, and tell Peter. he loved Peter so much. He wanted him to know that everything was all right, that salvation had come. He was the deliverer now. Peter was one of the recipients of forgiveness and mercy and grace. A new, the Bible says, a new and living way. How many of you know we don't have to go through the old law and all the old sacrifices? There's been one sacrifice now, and he was the ultimate sacrifice. He doesn't want you to follow a preacher. I get so tired of that stuff. I mentioned this in the 9 o'clock service. Don't be that kind of person. Don't follow after men. Don't follow after preachers. Preachers are nothing more than another human that got saved, sanctified, and filled, and they got called. And you follow them only as they follow Christ. Don't you follow me. I will disappoint you. Every other preacher will disappoint you too. Don't you follow after preachers. Don't follow after a doctrine or a denomination. Don't follow after trends and traditions of this life. You follow after the prize. You press towards the prize for the mark of the high calling of Christ Jesus. Amen. He doesn't even want you to follow after mama's religion. My mother was a Holy Ghost-filled, Pentecostal, holiness woman. But I can't get in heaven based on the fact that she was close to God. You can't get into heaven based on the fact that your family was close to God. You can't get in that way. The Bible is clear to point out, he come to seek and to save everyone. For God so loved the whole world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, that's you and me. We're individuals. We can't get in on daddy's religion or mommy's religion. If your mama's saved and she's going to heaven and you don't have a relationship with Christ for yourself, then mama's going to heaven and so far you're not. That's some tough stuff. Sometimes we think because mama got it all together, I'm just a shoo-in. You've got to know him for yourself. But here's the awesome thing about that. He wants you to know him. He rose up out of that tomb and went looking for his people. And he's still looking for his people, even in this hour, this morning. He's so full of passion and love for his people. He came, he says, to destroy the works of the enemy and to seek and to save that which is lost. He's known as a shepherd looking out for his sheep. He's trying his very best to find you right where you hurt the most. And you may have gone deep. You may be hurting, bleeding, bruised, and battered from the circumstances of this world. But I got good news for you. He came out of the tomb with healing in his hands. He came out of that tomb with deliverance for your spirit and your heart. He wants to turn it around for you. Acts 17 and verse 27 says that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him. Though he be not far from every one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being. Can I tell you this morning, he's as close to you as any other entity anywhere. He's so close to you right now, you could reach out and touch him. And he loves you. No, I don't care what the world's told you. I don't care what all the philosophers of this life have told you. I don't care what the educators tell you. I don't care what the humanists tell you. All those people out there, I'm telling you what, there is still a true promise in God's word that he loves you with an everlasting love. And he is there for you. You may get knocked sideways. You may get knocked down. You may feel at times like you are wrestling the very devil himself. But understand and know this. He is more than overcome every temptation, every persecution, every torment that you and I have ever gone through. Jesus has already overcome, and you and I already are delivered and victorious in Christ. Amen? Amen. Amen. Then came the morning. As I mentioned, I love mornings. I love what a morning represents. I have a little plaque right by my front door. It says, today is the first day to the rest of your life. I read that when I'm leaving every morning. Just today is the first day to the rest of your life. It doesn't matter what happened yesterday. It's a brand new morning. It's a brand new day. How many of you know God is the God of do-overs? He's the God of a second chance. He's a God of forgiveness and grace. He's a God of mercy. He wants you and I to know, man, he's not looking to cast you out. He's looking to bring you in. He wants you to know him in great power. Some folks walk around like God's forgiveness is awful tiny. Some folks live their lives as if, man, you gotta turn flips and hoops and you gotta run miles and you gotta do all kinds of stuff in order to get that mercy from God. Let me tell you something. There's more power in one drop of the blood of Jesus Christ to cover the deepest, darkest sin you and I have ever seen or committed in all of our lives. Can I tell you? God loves the murderers. God loves the darkest of us among our people. He loves those that are in drugs and alcoholism. He loves the prostitute on the street. He loves that lady as much as he loves you. That's the awesome thing about our God. If we'll know that and see that and feel that, embrace that, man, it's like the empty tomb just comes alive to us. Isn't it wonderful that he gave us an empty tomb? He didn't have to. He didn't have to roll that stone away. I mean, he was Jesus several different times. He walked right through walls. He walked on water. He didn't have to do that. He did that for you. He wanted you to know when that angel rolled that stone away from there, and it'll happen this weekend. When that stone rolls away, Jesus did that not so he could get out. How many of you know he was already on his way out? He'd already been out and came back. That wasn't so he could get out. That was so you could see in that he's not there, that he's risen from the dead. And if he's risen from the dead, then you and I know the promises of the resurrection are true, not only for him, but for you and for me. Then we know our loved ones that are already over at Woodside Cemetery, our loved ones who've already been lost or died, they've been, goodness gracious, they have passed away. Those precious loved ones of ours that have passed away, we know that we know that we know that the word of God is true. He will bring us all back together again. There's a reunion day coming. There's a love coming again for our families and all those that we love. The resurrection is for you and I. And when we've experienced that new life in Christ, he gives us life. He said, I went down those 3 days that he was in the tomb there. He left out of the tomb, went down into the caverns of hell. The Bible says he conquered death, hell, and the grave. Can you imagine that? I mean, death came up there, snatched him up off the cross, and then Jesus turned right around, went right back down there and said, oh, yeah, I just let you do that. Give me the keys. Give me the keys. Do you think for 1 minute that death wanted to let go? Death thought he had him. Death thought that the grip was there and it was permanent. But Jesus lifted up his eyes. It says he gave up the ghost. He said, it is finished. Dropped his head. He died. And then Jesus came down off the cross and went straight into the cavern and said, give me the keys. I want the keys, not only death, though I want your keys, but oh, hell, I want your keys and grave. Yeah, grave. I want your keys. You'll never be able to hold them. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down because I belong to the Lord who has captivated all the keys. Mornings. Then came the morning. Then came the beautiful morning. We remember Abraham. It says it was very early in the morning in Genesis chapter 22 when he climbed up that hill with his son Isaac. The news was bad. The death was sure. The sacrifice was there. The sadness was there. But his trust and his faith, God will provide, he told his son. When he got up to the top of that hill, he looked over there and saw the sacrifice, the ram, caught in a thicket there waiting on him. You know, you and I have to understand God is always 2, 3, 4, 5 steps ahead of us. You are never walking into anything. But as far as I know, and everything I read tells me that we walk in the shadow of the Almighty. He is always there. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of even death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. You and I, he's a refuge. He's a strong tower. He's a covert in the storm. Imagine the morning the disciples woke up after that storm all night long. Oh, they saw that sunshine. They thought it was beautiful. There's something about a beautiful, fresh, brand new morning to make you know everything's going to be all right. I'm telling you, the Lord has got a brand new morning for you. You've been in a dark place. You felt buried. You felt so discouraged, and you have felt things. I know this. I've already prayed over this. You're here today, and you have felt like you've just been in one wrestling match after another. You feel like you have just been in one war after another. You're battle beaten, and you got all kinds of stuff going on, and you're trying to work it out. You have been doing everything in your power, and you've exhausted yourself trying to fix it and take care of it and make it all right. But it's time. You're here. God appointed for you to be here now to let you know he came out of that tomb so you could be victorious, so you could be set free and liberated from death, hell, and the grave. There's nothing that can take hold of you that God can't turn it around right now. He can loose you from any trouble, trial, anything you've ever had go on. God can loose you from it right now. I know that. You're going to have to deal with me, because I am so confident this morning when I walked out of that hospital and I looked up and I saw that God had healed Kristen and brought her through that surgery and kept that baby alive. When I walked out of there, I was reading the scripture that says, I can run through a troop and leap over a wall. I can run through the valley. I can walk on the water. I can do anything, because I felt the presence and power of God. I told my brother-in-law yesterday, I told him, I said, I've been, you know, it's been tough around here lately. There have been 40 deaths since October, and it's been overwhelming for our staff, and there's been a lot of stress and a lot of stuff go on. And I'll tell you, I'll be honest with you, it kind of weighs on you sometime. And I'm just confessing now. The only reason I'm confessing is because God delivered me. See, I wouldn't get up here. I would never get up here. I mess on the devil all the time. When I'm in my prayer time, I get down there. I'm like, Lord, you touch the church. Lord, you do this. Father, I'm praying for healing for sister so-and-so. I'm praying for deliverance. I'm praying for the lost to be saved. I'm praying for this. And now, Lord, we're going to talk about me. I've got that. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't let him know nothing. I don't tell him nothing. He can't read my mind. He can't get down inside my heart. So every time I ain't going to belly ache and whine and grumble. I ain't going to do all that stuff and let the devil know he's winning. I'm going to always try to keep my composure. And so I'm going to always walk with my shoulders, you know, strong and back. And I'm going to be always, always ready to give an answer for why I have faith in the midst of it all. But I can tell you now, I was weighed down. I was drained. I was exhausted mentally, emotionally, even spiritually, felt the burden and the weight of it. And other staff members felt the same way. It's been a tough couple of months. But I don't know what it was. God just has a way. He uses, how many of you know all things work together for the good? And when I walked out of that hospital, Craig, man, I walked out. I was walking to my car. I felt light in my step. I felt good. I was singing in my car. I was worshiping. I was praising God. I was calling people on the phone. God performed a miracle at Kettering Hospital today. He performed a mighty, mighty miracle. The waters parted and all the power of God fell. I told him that. I was excited. I went to the house with, took a walk last night with some of our family. I got back, get in my car on my way home, and I'm just like, I'm still feeling good. I'm feeling like Rocky. I'm feeling like I can do anything. You know what? The power of God, he always is one step ahead. The devil may knock you down, but God reaches out and pulls you right back up. There is no defeat for the child of God. That's what's awesome.
That's why I serve him like I do. That's why I get excited. You know, I've already wrestled with all that, you know, about just trying to be a lot more. So wonderful to see you today in the house of the Lord. Please stand with me as we quote the 23rd Psalm. I can't help it. It's like fire that's shut up in me. I get excited, not because of who I am, but because of who he is and what he can do. I don't want to serve him like I am a fan. Man, if I'm a fan. I'm a fan of Jesus. And when he does something amazing and awesome, I'm ready to go out there and rally. I'm ready to go out there with fire in my heart. I want to do the best that I can for the Lord. I want to give him glory and honor and praise him and thank him for what he's done. He's looking for people who will honor him and love him. He says, look at me, handle me, see me. Got food? I'll eat food. I'll do anything you want if you'll just believe in me. I'll do what you're asking me to do. He wants to show himself powerful, wants to show himself mighty on your behalf. I kind of like that stage. That's kind of cool. Mornings. All right. Oh, my goodness. My zero. It's 000. I have no time left. Stand with me this morning. The awesome thing about that empty tomb, Sandy Patty used to sing this old song. Got the words here somewhere. It says, was it a morning like this when Mary walked down from Jerusalem and two angels stood at the tomb, bearers of news she would hear soon? Was it a morning like this when Peter and John ran from Jerusalem and as they raced towards the tomb, beneath their feet was there a tune? Did the grass sing? Did the earth rejoice to feel you again? Over and over like a trumpet underground, did the earth seem to pound? He is risen! Over and over in a never-ending round, he is risen. Hallelujah, he is risen. Telling you, the world knows it. The earth knows it. The trees know it. The birds know it. The question is, do you? Jesus looked, he wants to be known so bad. He looked at his disciples, Liz, and he said, who do men say that I am? I mean, he's looking at the whole earth. He's looking at every one of you today. Jessica, Charlie, he said, man, who do you say that I am? He's looking at everybody. Debbie, Doug, who do you say that I am? Hans, who am I? Who am I? Am I just your religion? Am I just your faith? Am I just your doctrine, your denomination? Who am I? Jesus says, answer the question, who am I? Right about that time, Peter jumped up. Several of them said, well, you, John the Baptist, Elijah, people are saying some people tell us you're a devil. Peter jumped up, sitting right there by the rock. Jumped up. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the Son of God. That's who you are. That's who you are. And Jesus looked at him and said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed that to you, but my Father, which is in heaven, has revealed that to you. He said, and you, on that truth, on what you just now said, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell itself will not prevail against it. Woo-wee. We are more than conquerors through Christ. I can do all things through Jesus who strengthens me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I am a child of God. I've been grafted in the vine. I am joint heir with Jesus Christ, and I am his child. Amen. If you're a child of God, put your hands together and give him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory to your name, Lord. That's why we get excited. You know why? Because the tomb is empty. We don't serve a statue. And guess what? We don't serve a Jesus still on the cross. We preach the cross here. If it wasn't for the cross of Calvary, we wouldn't have salvation. That's the gospel message. But understand this. Jimmy, Jesus, he's not on the cross. Take him off the cross. He came off that cross and they buried him in that tomb. And then he walked out of that tomb. We're serving a savior of the empty tomb. I like that. Let's start a new denomination. No, I'm kidding. Power of God. The power of God. Every head bowed and every eye closed. So many people here today. Lots and lots of people here. I'm so glad you came. I believe you're here on purpose. I believe that God has appointed for you to be in this house today. I'm asking you to meet Jesus. Because see, he comes out of the tomb searching for his people. Are you his people? Is he looking for you? The Holy Spirit is knocking on some folks' hearts this morning because he's looking for you. He doesn't want you left out. He died for you. He rose from the dead for you. He's looking to redeem you, to pay the price for your sin. You've disappointed your family and friends. You've failed in so many ways. You've struggled. You've fought. And you know in your heart, you can feel the tug down inside you right now. You know that God has been chasing after you. He left that tomb. You're one of the people he's been searching for. And he says, look, I'm real. Look, touch, handle me. I'm real. I've come for you. Oh, you say, no, not me. Yes. I know that I know that I know he's come for you today. Don't let the voices of this world, the influences of this world touch you or change your mind right now. God is knocking on your heart's door, and there's only one response. You got to open that door and say, come on in, Lord. Let him come into your life. With every head bowed and every eye closed, you need Jesus. You need things squared away and right with him. You need to secure your own relationship with him. You need him so much. You need the Savior you once knew. Maybe you come from a life where you've gotten away from the Lord, or you've gotten off track. You know that inside your heart right now, it's beating 1,000 miles a minute. The Holy Ghost is doing his work, because the Bible says that no man comes to the Father except the Spirit draws him. You aren't responding to a preacher. You're not responding to a service or music. You're responding to Jesus, who loves you. And he wants to save you this morning. He wants to save you. Greatest decision you'll ever make. I thought the night I got saved, I sat in that chair and I literally fought forever. I was fighting. I didn't want to do it. I wanted to run out the back door. I didn't even know why. I wanted to run out of the place. I wanted to leave as quickly as I could. Just get out. The voice screaming in my head was just, get out of here. But instead, I went with that still small voice that was placed down in my heart. And I stood up and I went to the altar. And my life has never been the same since. I didn't understand why I had fought so hard, because this beautiful morning in my life, this new do-over, this fresh start was so perfect and beautiful. I loved every second of it. Jesus wants you to know him. He's looking for you. And if you're here today, you need to make things right with Jesus. You want to accept him into your heart and life. I want to give you that opportunity right now where you stand. We're going to make an altar at your seat right where you're standing. I want you to be able to go to the Lord with no hindrances from man. I don't want anybody in the way. I want you and Jesus to make a decision right where you stand. We're going to pray a prayer. It's not a magic formula. It's not a pre-written prayer that automatically gets you a receipt for heaven. It's just a guide for you. It's just, the Bible says, if a man or a woman will believe in their heart, confess Jesus as the Son of God, believe that with all their life and confess it with their mouth, then they're saved. So we're going to help you by praying a prayer with you that will give you that ability to be able to own him as your own Savior. To ask him to come into your life. If you're here and you need salvation, would you just slip up your hand and write back down real fast? Are you here today? Pastor, I want to pray that prayer with you. I want to be saved today. Just shoot your hand up and write back down. Are you here? Christians are praying. Anyone at all? Just going to wait a few more seconds. I believe you're here, but I'm not going to. God bless you. God bless you, sir. Thank you. I knew you were here. There's probably someone else. Are you waiting? You need to make things right with Jesus. We're going to pray the prayer right now, just a few more seconds. If you went in on that prayer, you're saying, God, I'm responding to you. I'm coming to you today. This is my turnaround day. This is my morning today. Are you here? Is there anyone else? I'm waiting. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. All right. Several have lifted their hands. We're going to pray right now. Church, let's join them in this prayer. Let's pray this together. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. You are the Son of God. You died on the cross. You rose from the dead. You purchased my salvation. Be the Lord of my life. I give you everything. I believe you in my heart. I confess you with my mouth. So according to your word, I'm saved. I'm born again. I'm a child of God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise God. And now let's pray together. Would you just make contact with someone right beside you just for a second? I try not to do this too much because these days people don't like to hold hands with strangers. If you'd like to make that contact, you can put a hand on a shoulder, anything nice, but let's pray together. Father, we come to you. Lord, don't let us get off track. Don't let our faith fade. Don't let us get in a stupor, Lord, where we let all the cares of life cause us to forget how real you are. How on purpose you are in our lives. Touch this congregation with a hunger and a thirst for you like they've never had before. No, I pray this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I thank you for our church. I thank you for the people that are being saved. I thank you, Lord, for all you're doing in our congregation. We are just standing back in awe of all that you're up to and all that you're doing to raise up this church as a place, a kingdom center for you. We honor you. We bless you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Richard?
Amen. Amen. As you go today, we want to remind you again about the meet and greet that's happening right across the lobby. If you prayed a sinner's prayer today, we would love to give you some information as you start your journey. Melissa Grawl, our discipleship pastor, is down here right in front. She would love to meet you out in the lobby at our discipleship booth. Also, if you're here for the first time, we'd invite you to go down to the information desk in the new lobby, and they will have some information to give you. All right, God bless you all. Be praying this week. Invite family, friends. And we are looking forward to next weekend, a beautiful time for us all to be together. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.